forecast for today, and we can have a rainy day practice schedule. Athletes, please check the bulletin board to see your time for practice. As a reminder, when in our auditorium, in the case of an emergency, please walk. Do not run to the exit. Please take a moment to turn off all cellular telephones or any other electronic devices that may disturb others and disrupt the performance. Note that photography of any kind is strictly prohibited in the auditorium. Our motivational thought for the day is, I wondered why somebody didn't do something. Then I realized I was somebody. Thank you. And have a happy Super Seagull Day.
Today is my bitter 16th birthday. Welcome to the Y2K Teen Angst Apocalypse. I've been thinking about the mosaic Hope gave me the night she U-hauled ass out of Pineville, New Jersey for good. For well good, to be exact, as in well good, Tennessee. Population, 6,345. Make that 6,348. I finally had an explanation for the mysterious scraps of paper scattered across her bedroom floor. For months, Hope had been covering up pages from magazines, pictures of school buses and pumpkins to capture the color of her curls, chocolate bars and beer bottles for my ponytail. I've been staring at it, trying to figure out how she glued those tiny pieces together to recreate my favorite photo, taken exactly 1 year ago today. Hope and me at 4 a.m., wide awake and laughing, ready to sneak out to watch the sunrise on the morning of my 15th birthday. I remember that sleepover at Hope's house more vividly than anything I did today. Would you rather eat nothing but fish sticks or wear head-to-toe in-sync paraphernalia for the rest of your life? Would you rather be zit-free forever or fill a D-cup bra? We flipped through our eighth-grade yearbook and decided being voted class brainiac and class artist pretty much guaranteed geekdom until graduation from high school. About class brainiac, who will actually make something of her life and not end up working at Wawa. How about class artist who will contribute more to this world than misspelled graffiti on the bathroom stall of the Wawa that employs her best friend? We need to strip all the class characters of their titles and give them what they really deserve. Scotty Glazer, from most athletic to most middle-aged, yet totally immature at the same time. Van Powers, from biggest flirt to most likely to find out he's not the father on Mari. Sarah DeGruzzi, from class motormouth to future double agent who'll betray her country for free liposuction. Bridget Mihalkovic, from best looking to best bet she'll peak too soon. Bert Boyer, from half the class couple to, what was the name of that totally forgettable bro who de-virginized Bridget? They're all paying way more attention to me now that Hope is gone, but I still lack the Oscar-caliber star power of the truly popular. No, I'm like a Z-level celebrity, like an actress who makes her mark in Lifetime movies with titles like Daddy, May I Dance with Danger.
Bob!
It's so tragic. Isn't it tragic, babe?
Whatever you say, babe.
Oh my God, so tragic.
Yes, it's all so tragic. We all miss Hope.
Balls.
Here's what else I remember about my last birthday.
I made German pancakes topped with fresh lemon zest and powdered sugar for breakfast. I put a birthday candle on top and told Jessica to make a wish.
To be zit-free forever, and fill a deep cup raw. Keith came into the kitchen and snorted the sugar in imitation of some crazy comedian from the 70s, all hopped up on cocaine. I laughed so hard, I thought my stomach would come out my ears. I felt bad when Hope later explained to me why she wasn't so amused by her brother's antics. And when Heath died of a heroin overdose 6 months later, 6 months ago, she felt even worse. My mom and dad made countless excuses for the mid-year move back to their tiny hometown. They had to get me down there in time to start the third marking period. They had to move in with my grandmother so they could save money for college. But Jessica and I saw through the lies. We knew the truth, even if we never said it out loud. My parents wanted to get me out of Pineville so I didn't end up like my brother. Dead at 18. And now we have to pay for his mistakes. It isn't fair. Why couldn't the Weavers have waited 2 more weeks until after my birthday? I told my parents not to bother throwing me a sweet 16 party. First of all, I have never been sweet. Okay, maybe not never, but definitely not after the age of 3. That's when my baby blonde hair darkened and my attitude went with it. Earning myself the family nickname of Not-So, as in Jessica, Not-So Darling. R-D-R-R. Whenever anyone tried to talk to me, I'd yell, boring, and run away. I probably picked it up from my sister Bethany, who was 14 at the time, and spent hours in front of the mirror rolling her eyes and practicing kissy looks. I've never had to practice. I'm literally and figuratively hopeless. So, no 16th birthday celebration for me. Who would I put on the guest list anyway? I hate all my other friends.
Money girl at Pineville High. I could go to some pricey private school.
school, but I go public because my family's extra buckage gives me some social leverage. At a super shishi school full of bazillionaires, I know I'd be a scrub. My self-esteem was permanently trashed when my stepmom sent me to fat camp in the seventh grade.
And test number three! Manda, did the editors put her on the cover to make us feel better about ourselves, to send the message that we don't have to be perfect to be pretty?
Oh, please. Stop being so Naomi Wolf already. Yes, I read and reference feminist manifestos to make up for my borderline ho-bag behavior. I also wear these non-prescription Poindexter glasses to come across as less sexual and more intellectual. I'm an extreme virgin, holding out for Mr. Right, 6 feet tall, blonde, skis in the winter, surfs in the summer, flosses daily, drives the Jeep. Till he comes along, I'll do everything but with Mr. Wrong. Well-behaved women rarely make history.
Sorry, girls, no one wins. Only losers in this competition.
Now she is totally perfect.
Oh my god, totally.
I could do squats into white 3K and I would never have an ass like that.
That body does not occur in nature.
Jess would look like that if she got a boob job.
Ew, I would never get a boob job. I watched one on the Learning Channel once. The surgeon went in through the belly button. He stretched the skin like a wad of chewed up bubblegum and then shoved the silicone hooter sacks into place. Kaboom! Va-va-boom!
All we're saying is that your abs, ass, and legs are like totally perfect. You should take it as a compliment.
Oh my god! How did you eat all that and stay so skinny? That pepperoni pizza has at least 500 calories and 25 grams of fat. Not to mention 250 calories of non-diet soda.
Oh, I don't know. Maybe because I spend 2 hours after school every day not sitting on my ass, daydreaming about how perfect it looks in my bun hugger uniform, but hauling it around the track at practice. I'm not bulimic, but I definitely have the urge to puke right now.
How much longer, Jess?
How much longer what?
How much longer are we forced to attend your pity party?
But it's so tragic.
Oh my god, so tragic. She's so tragic.
Right, tragic. So tragic.
But it's been 2 weeks. Time for you to get over it already. She's gone. Move on.
Wait a second. Is this an intervention? Maybe I should make more of an effort to move on.
You totally should.
After all, you can only be in a bad mood for so long before you have to face the facts. It isn't a bad mood at all. It's just your sucky personality.
Oh my god.
Totally. We all miss Hope. We all miss Hope.
I mean, I knew her since kindergarten.
Me too.
We were friends with her a lot longer than you were. Wasn't Bridget your bestie for, like, ever?
I've known Bridget since the crib. She's my age and lives across the street. For the first 12 years of my life, these qualifications were all I needed in a best friend. Bridget's good looks are directly responsible for the demise of our friendship.
Remember that time, like, the summer before the start of the seventh grade? I went back to school shopping with you, your mom, and sister. Everyone thought I was a darling and you were the neighbor's daughter.
Yes, more than one salesperson commented on the trio's classically gorgeous genetics. Who could blame them all for assuming I was the homely non-relation?
It was so hilarious, even your mom and sister thought so.
I laughed along, hiding my humiliation. Hilarious! Not long after, braces came off and her boyfriend Burke got on. Bridget and I broke the habit of our friendship, and yet my mom still clings to the idea that Bridget is my bestest bud. This is one of the reasons why my mother can't comprehend why I'm so sad about Hope. Another one of those reasons is that my mother knows nothing about me, and my sister even less than that. If Stephanie had gone to high school with me, I would have hated her as much as I hate my friends. I would have been the younger dweeby sibling who's too cool to acknowledge in the halls. Thus, our 11-year age gap is a blessing. This bridesmaid's dress makes me look like a banana. The color is maize. It looks Chiquita to me. And who, bonus, once all the alterations are made, will have enough leftover material from the bust to make not only a matching handbag, but a whole set of luggage.
Do not let her put her hair between now and the ceremony.
Of course not.
Why not?
It needs to be long enough to put in a chignon.
A shit what?
Chignon.
Doesn't help.
An updo?
An updo, like a ponytail.
Not like a ponytail.
Okay, if it's not a ponytail, then I'm pretty sure I've never worn my hair the way you want me to.
You will for my wedding.
But I don't think I'll look good with my hair up.
All of my bridesmaids are wearing their hair up.
Why do we have to wear our hair in the same way?
Because uniformity looks better in the pictures.
You mean conformity. Why does looking good equal looking the same?
Mother!
When it's your big day, you can tell your bridesmaids to wear their hair however you want. Since it's not, listen to your sister. Considering I can't even get a date to the wedding, I doubt I'll be planning my own anytime soon.
What about Scotty?
Balls.
Scotty was my first and only boyfriend. We went out for exactly one day in the eighth grade. I bravely braced myself for my first kiss, a sweet peck on the lips in the parking lot before the buses pulled away. I had no idea he'd ram jam his tongue down my throat. I'll never forget the feeling, this wet, thing flip-flopping around my mouth like a desperate landlocked fish. So saliva sloppy. I needed a squeegee when it was over. And his mustache prickled like daddy's long legs. No way I'm kissing Scotty again. Never.
Balls.
Leader on the football, basketball, and baseball team.
Ah, yes, the Uber Jock triumvirate.
Balls, balls, balls!
So polite.
You were so polite, you wouldn't ask permission before tonguing my tonsil.
She likes to wallow, Mother. She needs to lighten up.
You know what she really needs?
She needs some perspective.
What, Mother?
She needs some perspective.
Yes, she does.
When the worst thing happening in your life is whether to invite an adorable football, basketball, and baseball player?
Ball.
You really think that's the worst thing happening in my life right now?
Isn't it?
When my mother isn't favoring her beloved firstborn, she's giving me lectures on life. Get some perspective is one of her favorites. If I put things in perspective, I wouldn't make such a huge deal out of the teensy-weensiest things, and I'd be a much happier person. But her whole perspective spiel blows off my feelings at that moment. If something crappy happens, say when my best friend moves away 2 weeks before my birthday, my negative reaction is legit, right? It may not be as vivid as coming down with Ebola, but it's just as valid. It's not my fault. These are the problems I've been put on this earth to deal with. They're petty. They piss me off. And they're all mine. What's worst of all is that I'm totally aware of how ridiculous I am, especially after what Hope and her family have gone through. I know how small my problems are, but that doesn't stop me from obsessing. Why does everything I see bother me? Why can't I just get over these daily wrongdoings? Why can't I just move on and make the best of what I've got? How do other people get happy? I wish I knew.
Be aggressive! Be aggressive! B-E-A-T-G-I-V-E!
on the floor way too long after for the fumble to be a result of the collision. Yet I know he is the only one in Pineville worthy of my virginity. He's been accepted early decision to Columbia University, so he's super smart. And when I see him without a shirt on at track practice, I want to lick the sweat off his face. Lately, I've been having a special bitter 16 variation on my standard. Paul Parlapiano and I get stuck in an enclosed space together, and the trauma bonds us sexually and otherwise daydream. And this one, it's my birthday, and Paul Parlapiano and I are locked inside the gym closet.
How'd we get locked in here?
As always, how we got locked in is inconsequential. At first, he's none too happy to be trapped in there with me, of all people.
I'm none too happy to be trapped in here.
And though I'm secretly thrilled, I pretend to be totally bummed because it's my bitter 16. And what kind of psycho would be thrilled to spend a birthday in a closet full of stinky gym equipment?
It stinks in here.
Eventually, he talks to me because we've been in there for hours and there's nothing else for him to do. And Paul Parlapiano and I share the most fun, enlightening, intelligent, and all-around awesome conversation in both of our lives.
That was the most fun, enlightening, intelligent, and all-around awesome conversation of my life.
Mine too.
So, is this still the worst birthday you've ever had?
Not anymore.
Well, I can think of one way to make it better.
And then he slowly walks over to me, cups my totally zit-free face in his hands, and ever so gently kisses me on the lips. We break away for a brief second, look each other in the eyes, and smile. Then we start kissing again, but this time with more passion. And then we tumble onto the totally dirt-free gymnastics mat that's conveniently behind their house and share the sweetest and not at all awkward sexual experience to ever occur within the hall of Pineville High.
Cheerleaders, work hard on winter formal. And who is up for the rigorous reporting needed for basketball team gears up for winning season?
Balls.
administration cracks down on inappropriate public displays of affection. faculty lounge gets new menu.
I'm not signing up for any of these sorry ass stories.
What did I miss?
Nothing.
Say nothing in your journal, or a different category of nothing?
You're right on time, Mr. Flutie. I need 250 words on the food service team's Better Nutrition Initiative.
Can I trouble you?
Can you trouble me?
Can I trouble you? For a piece of notebook paper? Can I trouble you for a writing utensil?
How important is free speech to you?
Free speech?
Yes.
I don't really think about free speech well.
You should think about it more.
I'll take that under consideration.
I've been very impressed with your writing so far this year. You put a unique spin on the holistic essay topics. How technology has affected society, for example. You noted how advances in communication can be more of a burden than a blessing.
Even our totally guilt-free guidelines for keeping in touch?
Specifically, how screens are inferior substitutes for face-to-face connection with your long-distance best friends.
Snail mail once a month, call once a week, email IM once a day.
Constant contact undermine hopes of cats to make friends in her new home?
But only if we want to. Because the moment our correspondence feels like an obligation, there's no point in doing it anymore.
Does it keep you too attached to a friendship that can never be the same again?
You set the rules and I agree, remember?
Not many students can imagine a world without technology, let alone see the advantages of the way things used to be. Congratulations! You are the new op-ed columnist for the Seagull's Voice.
What? Me?
No. Why not? I don't see a point in writing for a newspaper that nobody reads.
Well, if no one reads it, then you've got nothing to lose, do you?
Hi. Plus, it will look great on your transcript. The Ivy League loves well-written applicants. Fine. I've already come up with the topic of my first editorial.
I'd love to hear it.
Why mandatory participation in school activities is a flagrant abuse of administrative powers and other forms of fascist suckiness. That's the spirit. Tell the truth, we don't want to hear. If you don't make somebody mad, there's little point in writing.
What if I make everybody mad?
Then you're really on to something.
Mr. Flutie, I couldn't have said it better myself.
You're welcome.
I think you mean thank you.
Shitting on?
You should be more concerned about the part in your hair than you are about wearing it up.
What do you mean my part is fine?
Well, sure, it looks fine in the mirror.
And that's fine because that's what I look like.
No, it's not. Stand here in front of these two mirrors so the reflection of one bounces off the other.
Like this? Oh my God, it's the reverse of my reverse image.
That's what you really look like.
I knew that numbers and letters were backwards in the mirror, but I never thought the same principle applied to faces.
And she is the smart one?
My hair is parted on the wrong side, and have my nostrils always been so uneven? One comes in from the front, but the other one comes in from the side. I knew I didn't photograph well, but this is what I really look like? How can I possibly go out in public?
You've already been at it for 16 years.
Maybe Scotty doesn't even notice. If Scotty can see past my wonky hair and freakish nostrils, maybe I should forgive and forget his tongue.
Some urine.
What? Why?
Perhaps you have noticed my presence in your honors classes.
Perhaps.
Perhaps you are aware that I have not always been in your honors classes.
Perhaps.
I am in your honors classes because my standardized test scores put me in the top 1% of the population.
Top 1%? Sarah said you were in the top 2%.
I assure you, I am very gifted and very talented. Like many before her, Sarah underestimates me.
Sarah underestimates you?
Marcus Flutie is packing 10 inches of New Jersey white snake.
My therapist believed my disciplinary issues and addictive behaviors were caused by lack of educational stimulation. I entertained myself with illicit substances and shenanigans because I wasn't being challenged at school. To avoid messy arbitration, the administration enrolled me in your honors classes. If I'm caught engaging in illicit substances or shenanigans, I'm out for good. Goodbye, Pineville High. And that's why I need you to piss in this.
You want me to fake your drug test? Are you insane? I don't even know you.
Yes, top clinicians have determined that I am perfectly sane. And I know you better than you think.
How do you know me?
I know you think I'm a drag who deserves to be busted, but I really have cleaned up my act. No illicit substances and hardly any shenanigans.
Then why do you need to trouble me for my urine?
Because I can't really say the same for my friends. I might have gotten a contact, huh? But I didn't inhale, really.
What about your girlfriend, what's her name?
Mia. And she definitely inhaled.
Of course she did. Wait a second, isn't this a violation of your constitutional rights?
As a minor and a repeat offender, I have no rights. Call the ACLU. Look, if you don't do this, I'll get kicked out of school for good. You'll be saving my life. And I'll owe you a favor. And I never go back on promise.
Can't.
I knew you wouldn't do it.
Hey! I'm so sick of everyone telling me what to do.
Get over it. Get a boob job.
Get involved.
Get a date.
Get a boyfriend, balls.
Get
get over it.
Get involved.
Get a date.
Get a boyfriend.
I knew you wouldn't do.
You don't know me. How do you know